All right, so you know you've got your model training and you want to make it a little bit better. So this video is kind of like a sequel to the video on convolutional neural networks, and I want to talk about learning rate and batch size and a couple ways that you can often make your models better. Now, unlike a lot of other courses on deep learning, I don't really start with learning rate and batch size and things like that because I do think beginners tend to spend way too much time kind of optimizing and tweaking these parameters where they don't really matter that much. But they can matter and they can be really effective for making your models train faster or kind of getting the last piece of performance out of your model. So just as a quick refresher, the learning rate is kind of like the size of the step that the model makes as it's looking for the best possible weights. So, you know, really low learning rate will mean that your model might take a really long time to find the best set of parameters. And a really high learning rate might mean it's kind of jumping over the best possible place or even sort of jumping into regions where you get numerical instability. Batch size, you might remember, is the number of examples that a model looks at when it decides which direction to send all the weights. So, you know, a really small batch size means that each step your model's optimizing only, say, over one example or two examples, it could add a lot of noise to your model. Now, a really big batch size, sometimes it doesn't have enough noise and it's hard for the model to actually find the best place. So on one hand, smaller batch sizes actually can ironically help your model train better by adding a little bit of noise into that search. But maybe a bigger effect or another important effect is that a bigger batch size can help your model train faster, especially on GPUs, because on a GPU, you can actually compute the derivative on all the batches all at once. So sometimes, as long as you can fit this batch into memory and an associated model into memory, a bigger batch size might not actually slow down your training by much at all. In fact, that computation might be sort of atomic and the same speed regardless of your batch size. Now, if you set your batch size too big, it just won't fit into memory and your thing will crash. So at that point, you'll know that you need to reduce your batch size. But one thing I see with a lot of people starting out is I think they tend to set their batch size too small and waste more time in their training than they really need to. So let's jump into the code and run some experiments. So I'm going to do these experiments on the CIFAR data set that we've used in a previous class on data augmentation that you should probably take a look at if you haven't already. So we're going to do the standard imports, and then we're going to pull in the CIFAR 10 data set. You know, these things tend to be different on different data sets, but I wanted to use a data set that's small enough that we can run a lot of experiments quickly, but maybe not MNIST, where that's actually so small that you might get unusual results. So as usual, I normalize the data and convert the labels into one hot encoded versions of themselves. And I'm going to start with a very, very small convolutional network, probably smallest possible convolutional network with just one convolution and one pooling layer. So certainly you can make this network bigger and get better performance, but I kind of want to see what happens as we modify the learning rate and the batch size first. So the first thing I want to show you is what happens if you set the learning rate to something very small. So, you know, by default, Adam sets the learning rate to 0.001, right? So let's see what happens if we set it to 0.0001. Okay, so here the blue line is the accuracy of the CNN with the lower learning rate, and the orange line is the accuracy of CNN with the default learning rate. And so you can see lower learning rate, nothing really bad happens, but it learns slower, and that can be really annoying when you're training lots of models, right? So when I see this blue line, it's consistently below the orange line, although I think that'll probably catch up over time. Okay, so suppose you look at this and you say, you know what, learning rate of 0.0001, that doesn't work as well as the default 0.001. Let's raise it up by a few factors. Let's make it say 0.1. This would be considered a pretty high learning rate, but you know, who knows, maybe the model will learn faster. So here we call model.fit, and look at that. We see an accuracy of about 10%, and it's not even getting better. Another real telltale sign is that our loss is 14. Now remember, a loss is kind of in log space, really it's like log loss. So if you see a loss that's, you know, above 4 or 5, you should think of that as a massively huge loss, right? I think like what's actually happening here is that the model's returning like nans and infinities and just crazy things, right? And so this model is never gonna get better. It just sits at a loss of 14 and an accuracy of 10%. And you remember we have 10 classes, so an accuracy of 10% is really the model's just guessing, right? So this is what happens when you set the learning rate too high. You get in a really, really bad place. So lower learning rates tend to be safer than higher learning rates. What about batch size? So, you know, our default batch size is 32. What happens if we set it to, say, 128, right? So this is a 4x increase in batch size. If we call model.fit, the first thing you'll notice is that it takes a little bit longer to start because it's loading more into memory, but then actually it runs a lot faster. And so that's actually pretty nice. But, you know, if it runs faster and we sacrifice accuracy, that's not very interesting. And remember, it's running faster because each step that it's taking is over a bigger chunk. So it's looking at the same number of training examples, but it's doing it in larger chunks. All right, cool. So so here, and I think this is the reason that people often use don't use larger batch sizes. The CNN with the 128 batch size is that each step is faster, but it's actually performing worse than the CNN with the smaller batch size. But there's actually a subtle point there that's important to know, which is that as you increase the batch size, you should also increase the learning rate. So if you multiply the batch size by 4, you should also, generally speaking, multiply the learning rate by 4. So with bigger batches, because you're averaging over a larger number of samples, you can get away with higher learning rates than you otherwise could. So let's try this 128 batch size again, but with a 4x learning rate versus the baseline 32 batch size. Okay, so actually what you see here is that when we 4x the learning rate with the larger batch size, now we get the best of both worlds. So we have a CNN that's training faster, and it's training at about the same level of accuracy and validation accuracy as our baseline CNN. So one more fancy thing you can do, and especially this is really effective when you train over a large number of epochs, is you can reduce the learning rate on plateau. So the idea here is that once your model kind of gets stuck and can't find a better optimum, it lowers the learning rate so it can kind of fine tune in the area that it's in, right? So there's actually, this is such a common technique that there's actually a Keras callback that we can just use that'll do it for us. It has lots of options, but you know the defaults as usual are pretty sensible. So we just add to our callbacks a callback reduce LR on plateau. And now, in order to get this effect, we actually have to have our learning actually plateau. So let's set the epochs to, say, 300 and time-lapse this a little bit to not make a really long video. OK, and so this model's been training for a while. And you can see what happened is, at about the 35th epoch, it stopped improving. And so our reduce learning rate system automatically reduced the learning rate, and you can see that the accuracy and the validation accuracy actually popped up quickly and then petered out. And with a lot of models, you actually see that effect happen a few times, each probably like a little bit smaller than the time before, but it can really add some accuracy on the end of your model training. So, you know, again, I don't think learning rate is always the first thing to mess with unless your model is really not training and you're having numerical issues. Generally, the Keras defaults are pretty good. And, you know, most people go through a phase, I think, where they spend too much time kind of changing the optimizer and, you know, changing, you know, momentum and things like that. But it definitely does make sense to understand what learning rate and batch size are and spend a little time tweaking them. And I think doing this kind of reduced learning rate on plateau system is generally best practice for long running, long training models. Thanks.